My name is Skip Masbach. I'm the Associate Director of the Yale Center for Faith and Culture and the Director of the Yale Youth Ministry Institute, and we are delighted that on a beautiful spring day you chose, maybe a little reluctantly, to eat inside and enjoy this wonderful program with us. Thank you for coming today. Before we move on with our program, I just want to do two things. I want to ask a word of blessing over the food, and then I want to talk to you about the summer program that you see in the brochures before you. So let's begin with the word of prayer. God, whom we call love, and who is made known to us in and through Jesus the Christ, we give you thanks for the sheer beauty of this day. We see your powers, mysterious though they be, in the created things all around us, and we certainly see them in the bright eyes and hope and possibilities in the beautiful children that we care for in our churches and communities. We thank you for this opportunity to gather as a community of folks dedicated to caring for your children. We thank you for this food that is set before us and ask your blessing on the food and the hands that prepared it. We ask that you would send your spirit to be amongst us as we gather, for we are two and more gathered in your name. And we ask that spirit lift and inform our speakers and open our ears and hearts to the truth they share. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, now you just got to pause for a second and just help me here. Throw me a bone by picking up this brochure. Just give me just a little action reaction. And now I want you to open it up and look at the program inside. When I was running a youth group in another career a million years ago as a younger person, we used to invest heavily in our senior leadership and seniors leading the youth group. And we'd take them on a leadership retreat every year and ask them to discern what is God calling you to contribute to lead the youth group during this year of your leadership. And most years, we would get pretty common prosaic answers. We're going to be more loving this year. Good, let's go do it. We're going to be more inclusive of the ninth graders. Good, let's go do it. We're going to do more service work. Oh, that's great, let's go do it. We're going to have more lively worship. That's great, let's go do it. In 2001, they said, "We are dying, and there's no one to talk to about it. We're dying, and there's no one to talk to about it." Well, okay, what are you dying of? And they had their list. The list is a little different from community to community, but there's some commonalities. In our community, it was suicide, depression, anxiety, eating disorders, substance abuse, sexual behaviors. Boom, they all know. What do you mean there's nobody to talk to about it? Well, you know how the football team has a linebacking coach that they make teach health so that they can pay him a full-time salary? We ain't talking to that guy about this. We're not talking to our mom about our eating disorder issues or our substance issues. We are so cut off, we don't even want to talk to each other about this. Wasn't it clear right at that moment that a church that proclaims the gospel of Jesus Christ, who comes that we may have life and have it abundantly, needs to speak a word into the lives of young people struggling with these issues? And there are psychological and social dimensions of each of these issues, but everyone has a spiritual dimension that the church has to speak to. But how am I going to talk about suicide and depression on Sunday night? I'm not really trained to do that. I'm not equipped to do that, but we have to. So ever since 2001, I have been dreaming about how to have a program that would bring the leading practical theologians and psychologists of the country together and offer youth ministers, caregivers, parents, ministers, lay workers, volunteers, the resources to minister well to our children and the things that are actually killing them. So we're going to do this for 3 summers. This is summer number 2. Look at these topics. And if I get to the end of these topics and this doesn't apply to your community, your church, a young person you know, just raise your hand. Broken families and family instability, fear in these times in particular, depression and suicide, sexual dimensions, violence. Anybody for whom these are not an issue for their kids or the kids they care about? Everybody has an opportunity to learn and be fed by this program. These are amazing scholars. Chap Clark founded the Fuller Program on Youth Ministry. Gregory Ellison is doing groundbreaking work at Candler Seminary, and his Fearless Dialogues is a program that we ran here 3 years ago. 275 folks came out for a night of fearless dialogues with Gregory Ellison. Nadja Riley and Sarah Farmer, Kate Hyde and Nadja Riley created the Harvard program on resilience in the face of suicide and depression that's now run out of Children's Hospital Boston. You can go right down this list, and every speaker has a unique gift to bring to help us address these concerns in our communities. But we need to make sure the word gets out so that ministers, youth ministers, volunteers, parents know that this resource is coming. This 5 nights will start at 6 o'clock in the evening with a delicious fellowship dinner, worship, community building activities, and go on with the lecture and question and answer until 9, Monday through Friday. The entire week is just your registration fee, one time, $50. Who was here for last summer's program? All right, was that a great program last summer? Yeah. Just give me a nod, right? Okay, if you have any questions about the summer program, please ask those folks. But my real ask of you is not only to take this away and reflect on it, it's would you help us understand who has an interest in this program that we can follow up with by filling out one of these forms. You'll see it on every table, Summer Study Attendance Interest Form. No leg hole trap's gonna close around your leg if you say yes, but if you give us your contact information, we can make sure you have all the information you need to register and follow up with you to give you any help you can. So would you please take a look at these forms, fill them out, and give them back to us before the end of today's gathering. And we're having another 250 of these brochures about this summer program delivered in about 15 minutes. I hope you'll all consider taking 5, 10 of these to take home to the parents, ministers, lay leaders, et cetera, that you know, so that this resource that we're gathering can be as helpful to as many people as possible. Amen? Amen. All right. I'd like to introduce my partner and my colleague in running the Yale Youth Ministry Institute, a member of the faculty here at Yale. She's an associate research scholar with the Yale Center for Faith and Culture, Dr. Sarah Farmer.
It is a true honor for me today to introduce our two speakers, two women whom I have great respect for. Our first speaker is Dr. Ann E. Streaty Wimberly. Dr. Ann is Professor Emerita of Christian Education at the Interdenominational Theological Center. She serves as the Executive Director of the Youth Hope Builders Academy at ITC, a youth theology program funded by the Lilly Endowment and with units across the world, including Ghana, Zimbabwe, Nigeria, Kenya, Australia, soon to be in Brazil, and here in our very own state of Connecticut. A prolific writer, Dr. Ann has over 12 published books, numerous denominational and other academic resources, chapters in books, and articles. This includes In Search of Wisdom, Faith Formation in the Black Church, Soul Stories, African American Christian Education, and Youth Ministry in the Black Church, Center in Hope. It's amazing to think that just a year ago, before coming on faculty at Yale, I lectured with Dr. Ann on hope. From that lecture, our book entitled Raising Hope, Four Paths to Courageous Living for Black Youth will be out in the fall. So this is just to give you insight to how efficient and sharp Dr. Ann is. She works really fast. Her current leadership further continues in her role as co-director of the Lilly Endowment-funded project entitled Connecting with Hope Innovation Hub, an initiative on young adult ministry. She is married to the Reverend Dr. Edward Wimberly, her husband of 50 years, an ITC professor and 9th president. I could go on and on with the numerous awards she's received, but I just want to say this about Dr. Ann on a more personal note. I worked on the executive staff of Youth Hope Builders Academy with Dr. Ann for over 10 years, and I benefited greatly from her nurturing spirit, her deep-seated passion for Black youth, her hospitality, her mentorship, her intellectual ingenuity, and her instructive narratives. And quite frankly, it was never too odd when youth, students at the seminary, and even faculty gave her the name Mama or Grandma Ann. What I've come to know as the truth about her is that she not only teaches about mentorship, care, and the village, she lives it. And I was a recipient of that gift named Dr. Ann. Lecturing with Dr. Ann, we have our very own Dr. Almeda Wright, who is Assistant Professor of Religious Education at Yale Divinity School. Her research focuses on African American religion, adolescent spiritual development, and the intersections of religion and public life. She is ordained in the American Baptist Church, and she co-edited with Mary Elizabeth Moore, Children, Youth, and Spirituality in a Troubling World. She has also served as editor of an issue of Practical Matters Journal. Now, Dr. Wright, this summer, you can get it this summer, has a new book coming out entitled, with Oxford University Press, entitled The Spiritual Lives of Young African Americans. And just to let you know, prior to her arrival at Yale, she served for 4 years as Assistant Professor of Religion and Youth Ministry at Pfeiffer University, and before that, an adjunct faculty member at the Candler School of Theology at Emory University. On a more personal note, Almeda and I have a special history, because Almeda was actually my first teaching assistant in an Introduction to Religious Education course I took at Candler as a master's student. And then as a PhD student at Emory, we participated in what we call the Wild Women, which consisted of women PhD students in practical theology. And in that group, as I was matriculating through as a PhD student, we and they modeled what it meant to be a village. And now here at Yale, I refer to Almeda as my big sister scholar. She's down to earth, brilliant, just plain fun to be around. So today, we are delighted to have a double whammy of rich lived experience, rigorous scholarship, and passion about the future of our youth. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Ann Wimberly and Dr. Almeda Wright.
Good afternoon. It is surely an honor to be back here at Yale and to be in this space to share with you about memory and joy. And as we share, we simply invite you to remember some occasions when someone said something to you or you saw something that somehow brings you joy even now and brings you through some rough times. So, let us begin. In the Africana worship book, a storyteller reveals in prose a precious memory. And she said, "I sat between two noble ladies today while we were shoulder to shoulder in church. The day was hot. Sweat rings formed around my neck while the two noble ladies shouldered on the Lord's day. On my left shoulder sat a woman about 45 years old. The laughter lines etched around her eyes were there from years of practice. Her eyes laughed a greeting my way while I sat there shoulder to shoulder. All through the service, she had happy feet, happy hands, happy hair, happy smiles. Happy rubs off, you know, when you sit so close. Before long, I was happy too. Shouldered with this woman, happy for her laughing eyes, glad for the songs which made my feet get happy, happy for the words of life flowing out to me. On the other side sat an old saint barely able to move in response to the moving of the Holy Ghost, which stirred our very souls. She shouldered me gently. I gentled her shoulder, which was bowed and stooped with age, which barely gripped mine in greeting. I reached for her gentle smile when she offered it to me. Her eyes were squinted with age and wrinkle-worn from seeing things I had not yet seen. Everything about this woman cried experience and wisdom. I longed to have that wisdom that was on my side. Infect me, as did the happiness on my left side, as we all sat shoulder to shoulder on the Lord's Day. The foregoing prose testifies to a quality referred to as happiness that in the Black community is claimed as joy. It also calls attention to the power of memory and the sought-after joy and wisdom of past generations. It offers an opening for us to reflect on a current-day quest for joy and understandings of what it means. In this presentation, we propose that there is, in the African-American heritage, lived experiences of joy that can enrich young people's, and for that matter, all of our understanding of and openness to joy in the daily sojourn of life. We propose that there is something worthy to be found in remembering the past. Memory is our ability as human beings to bring forth from the past something that is pertinent to us in the present. It's our capacity, even when we're not fully aware of it, to carry out particular tasks like putting on our clothes right side out instead of inside out, or accessing our email using you know what, our chosen password. This kind of memory is called procedural memory. Another kind of memory is semantic in nature. Semantic memory happens when we're able to call forth certain factual knowledge we've learned over time about the world and things around us. So, through this kind of memory, we can identify, for example, a hat, a horse, a house, and we know the difference between them. Psychologists also tell us that memory extends to recalling the details of events, people, places, and times. Referred to as episodic memory, this recall makes possible our entering a scene or experience in the past by traveling back to it, or engaging in what Endel Tulving calls mental time travel, in order to glean meanings of the past for the present and or our forward journey. Our purpose here is to move to still another view of memory called cultural collective memory, which has to do with our recalling the past based on a common experience or known story. It is embodied in rites, objects, monuments, and a variety of texts, such as prayers, music, poetry, sermons, scriptures, along with ideas, values, and norms. Collective memory makes possible our connecting with and learning from our heritage, as well as considering the future based on what is learned. Through it, the cultural past becomes a data bank, an identity-forming medium, and a stimulus for interrogating the present, grappling with current dilemmas, and seeing possibilities for life's journey ahead. This view is further epitomized in the West African Akan tribal view of moving forward while looking back that is captured in the symbol of the Sankofa bird. Notice, the bird has feet and a body that are directed forward, while the head and eyes look backward, embodying the idea of going back for what has been forgotten. Engaging young people in backward time travel is particularly important in this current age of less and less time and opportunity for cross-generational exchanges. Because of this, youth fail to gain knowledge of the lives of past generations and how forebears found joy amidst mayhem. It is also true that today's youth in African American community are talking about joy. They're searching for joy, as noted in contemporary expressions and conversations on what is called Black joy. In fact, millennial Cleaver Cruz used his Instagram account to create space to express Black joy and encourage others to do the same. He described being in a dark place and struggling to make sense of a personal loss, which actually was the death of his uncle, and so much of the violence and injustice going on in the world. He yearned for something else. He yearned for joy, and he said, "I started this Black Joy Project, as a means of working through darkness in my life, and that turned into a spiritual call to build community around this effort." But how do we connect young people with joy sought for and experienced in the past? What is the nature of joy in Black life that gave vitality to survival in the past and has something to say to us in the present? We found the answers in examples of prayers, music, poetry that we will present here today. Of course, these resources are only part of a collective memory that point to joy. In them, and a wide swath of other resources, we discovered extraordinary examples and meanings of joy that go beyond a simplistic or theoretically neat definition. What surfaced really was and is a multidimensional nature of joy. Black joy is searched and yearned for. People want to see, envision, experience joy in the midst of and beyond life's trials and tribulations. Black joy is expressed, embodied, and encountered. Joy is not simply expressed orally or verbally. It is expressed, embodied, and encountered in music, dance, smiles, shouts, hugs, food, laughter, shared between loved ones and even strangers. And as a result of religious celebration, overcoming critical life experiences. Black joy is cultivated and chosen. In spite of all that rails against joy, people make a conscious decision to enter into what they envision and expect to be a joy-promising and joy-infusing experience, most often with and invited by God. Black joy is resistance and justice. Joy is a way of being and triumphing or having the last word in the face of wounding, life-negating, and life-taking systems, structures, and societies that say Black people are not worthy of living, let alone enjoy it. Black joy is intergenerational, communal, eco-connected, and transcendent. Joy has vertical and horizontal dimensions. It doesn't happen in isolation. It is not one directional. It happens horizontally in relation to and in mutual exchanges across generations, in community, and with the natural world. It happens vertically in relation to God, in response to God's invitation to lean, trust, call on, and step out on God's word. In what follows, we will call to memory prayers, songs, and stories from the past that show these dimensions of joy. We'll end with a suggested curricular experience with adolescents into which you will be invited.
So we begin with prayers, or what Melvin Washington calls conversations with God. In his collection of prayers of African Americans from slavery through the mid-20th century. In our research, we attended to the emergence of joy as resistance that followed the coerced or what we call false joy, such as a false joy that was embodied of captives appearing to be in a good spirit or being forced to dance or sing while in chains and under the forced impetus of the whip for the amusement of their captors. We noted, though, that our ancestors turned this false joy upside down in their enslaved plantation life by creating clandestine spaces to reclaim control and engage in cultural, religious expressions and exchanges. At the center of the religious expressions was a quest for joy, as evidenced in their prayers. These prayers reveal a vital awareness, not simply of God as the source of joy, but of conversations with God as a way to gain access to this source and to an experience of joy. For example, Lemuel Haynes, as early as 1776, prayed to God for new birth in Christ, which meant embracing and living the qualities of Jesus Christ amidst the realities of life. Others, like Maria Stewart, use similar language in her prayers of 1834 that reveal a quest to overcome grief with joy that was deemed possible because of God's provision to her and through Christ's righteousness in the midst of the trials of life. But the quest for joy that overcomes adversity is, in fact, it's a dominant theme in the prayers of our ancestors. But in addition to these individual prayers, or prayers for personal experiences of joy, we also saw that many of the prayers were intercessory prayers. They were prayers on the behalf of others, on behalf of the whole community. They were prayers that sought joy as a collective and a communal good. For example, Daniel Alexander Payne prayed containing a passionate plea for gracious God of heaven to descend and spread love and make God's law resound to the extent that the chains of oppression wrought by the oppressors and felt by slaves would be crushed, resulting in the shouts for joy at holy freedom made possible by freedom's God. And yet another prayer by the likes of Jerina Lee expressed a desire for the Lord to sanctify her soul for Christ's sakes. She prayed for a kind of holy joy that is lived out in a person's relationship with other. And for her, this became her call to ministry. And in it, she experienced joy that no language can describe. Prayers to God, the source of joy, have persisted since the era of slavery. In the early decades of the 20th century, a continuing lament appeared in the prayers of Black people. And a persistent quest for joy appeared alongside a hope for freedom from oppression that infiltrated daily life in the era of slavery. In a lengthy poetic prayer of County Porter Cullens, written about 1925, Cullens laments to God about the experience of being dark in color. And this has brought him to the brink of despair. He is so desperate in his circumstance that he refers to a contaminated joy that is filled with hurt. And of course, the poetic prayer doesn't end there, but it points to the rich imagery, the lament, and the yearning for something more, which was and what are a part of prayers and this historical quest for joy. The quest of Langston Hughes, who was another poet and contemporary of County Cullen, is placed within a framework of a dream. And he writes, "I dream a world where man, no other man, will scorn, where love will bless the earth and peace its past adorn. I dream a world where all will know sweet freedom's way, where greed no longer saps the soul nor avarice blights our day. A world I dream where black or white, whatever race you be, will share the bounties of the earth and every man is free. Where wretchedness will hang its head and joy like a pearl attends the needs of all mankind. Of such I dream my world." Yet what we also noticed is that sometimes the quest stops short of the dream. Langston Hughes offers us a vision of a dream, but sometimes the quest and the prayers are plainly a deafening cry for the answer to the question raised by the psalmist in Psalm 22 and 1, and called forth by Jesus on the cross, my God, why have you forsaken me? These words are a recurring cry in the prayer of South African Bishop Desmond Tutu, and part of which is follows. He prayed this prayer, wrote this prayer, my God, why have you forsaken me? Our God, why have you forsaken us? Oh, my God, when will we ever learn? When will they ever learn? So even though we have drawn attention to the prayers of our ancestors and forebears that disclose their particular quest for joy, and we also draw attention to inviting young people into prayer, it's equally important for us to highlight the materials that we found that point clearly and necessarily to prayers for children and for youth. There are prayers that center on children, youth, are found most particularly in contemporary writings by people like Marian Wright Edelman. And in her prayers, we note particularly her awareness of the struggles of children and youth, and she intentionally centers prayer on their behalf. And this is important for us to model. And for example, I have up here a prayer of her for Hale House in Harlem for babies with HIV and AIDS. And she pleads simply, "Dear Father in heaven, this baby will not long live on this earth, but he will live forever with you. Grant this prayer that his remaining days will be full of happiness and joy that every infant deserves. Ease his pain, calm his fears, chase away his loneliness. Let him feel your eternal love through me. Amen." Similarly, she writes many other poems and prayers, like her Christmas prayer, which talks about standing with and for children. And she proclaims that adults need to pray for and stand with children, those who are joyful and those who are joyless. But it's also important for us, or what was most important for us as we were looking at these prayers, is that we have to point out that the prayers uncovered important information, uncovered information that shows how important our channel prayers can be for our conversations with God and about our personal and communal quests for joy. But there's something that we also wanted young people to remember about these prayers and practices. So our research highlights prayer as a necessary spiritual discipline in youth ministry. I know that seems like obvious, but I need to say it again. Prayer as a necessary and important spiritual discipline in youth ministry. And what we've also figured out is that prayers have existed in the past as Black people's conversations with God in search of joy, but we think and we hope and we contend that there is a similar place for prayer in the lives of current day youth. There is a great need for today's leaders to open up spaces for youth to hear the language of the prayers of our ancestors, to explore the circumstances and the meanings of these prayers, but also to name their own situations that call for prayer, and to enter into the experiences of praying. And so in this, we also note and recognize that prayers hold the language of lament. These prayers, in some ways, open the way for young people and those around them to give a necessary voice to their current experiences, such as violence and threats of harm, profound distress over personal struggles, family, community difficulties, disaster, disturbing political realities, and as well as self-negating local situations of injustice. So in voicing the realities of life in the language of prayer, also pushes us to assume and to encourage youth to assume that there is a God who listens, that God is a listening God who will receive their deepest cry and their toughest questions.
In addition to prayers focused on joy, we have also found that over the history of Black people in this country, the quest for joy, finding joy, and expressing joy appears in music. Often joy appears in the middle of or out of sorrow, despair, and pathos. In music, it comes amidst people's struggles of life and lament. In fact, theologian Barbara Holmes refers to the lament as a herald of joy. By this, she means that joy becomes possible when persons thirst for God in the midst of horrendous events, weep in the presence of a listening God, and are surrounded by those who weep and mourn with them. Her point is that there has to be a place, a time, and a relationship for lament to take place and the quest for joy to emerge. For a moment, let's consider memories from songs during the time of enslavement, a time when the question can surely be raised, how in the world was joy possible? Yet in truth, joy was both sought and surfaced in the throes of lament, in the hewn-out places for covert gatherings called brush harbors, our forebears' lament came in the words, "Sometimes I feel like a motherless child." But instead, at the end of the wail are the words, "True believer," which points to a belief that even feeling motherless is not the last word. There was something more and redeeming on the other side of sometimes. Likewise, the horizontal relational solidarity in community and vertical relationship with God made possible their testimony in song. Glory, glory, hallelujah, when I laid my burden down. I'm so glad. Trouble don't last always. Oh, Lord, shout for joy. Early in the morning, shout for joy. I've got peace like a river. I've got peace like a river. Do you know that? I've got joy like a river. I've got joy like a river. We camp a while in the wilderness, where the Lord makes us happy. And in another song, sit down, servant, I can't sit down. Sit down, servant, I can't sit down. Sit down, servant, I can't sit down. My soul's so happy that I can't sit down. Well, happiness came, and in fact, it was a sense of joy anyhow. These memories suggest that we as youth ministry leaders and other adults concerned about joy in the lives of today's young people must tend to it with them. We must tend to the places, communal habitations, and opportunities for lyric lament to become a herald of joy. The current day covert gathering places are brush harbors for them, are where they are, on Facebook, texts, tweets, doing carved out meeting times, in churches, and most of all, places named by them. Joy also permeated the difficult circumstances of the civil rights movement. The songs of the movement revealed not simply a quest for, but an expectation of joy to become concrete injustice that rolls down like water and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. Amos 5:24, we know it. An understanding of a coming joy was shown in the song, "We Shall Overcome." We shall overcome. We shall overcome someday. Oh, deep in my heart, I do believe we shall overcome someday. Joy as resistance to injustice and surety of moving through it is also noted, even as they sang in jail, "I'm so glad jail can't stop me now. I'm so glad jail can't stop me now. I'm so glad faith will see us through," singing glory, glory, hallelujah. "I'm so glad we shall overcome someday." However, in this current era, the question raised by Jania Butler in a Black Press USA article was, when will someday arrive? For her, against the current backdrop of seeming unrelenting hard times and experiences of failed justice, this question looms large. Clearly, she is about interrogating the past for its current meaning. Its meaning is further placed in juxtaposition with Timbaland's song, "Tell the children to watch out, keep running, they're gaining on us, keep on." And the cry of anger that prevails in the words of St. Louis rappers Nelly and Ali in response to the shooting of Michael Brown in Ferguson. "Hey, hey, ho, ho, these killer cops have got to go." Or the tweeted mantra, "We are ready to die tonight." But Jania Butler gives a response to her own question. "When will someday arrive?" she said. There's a simple answer. It someday will arrive when we decide it's going to happen. The theme of joy in Black life has continued in the messages of gospel music that emphasize a vertical, transcendent dimension. Among these songs are testimonies to the activity of God in situations of discouragement, as in the case of the early gospel song of Sevilla D. Martin. "Why should I feel discouraged? Why should the shadows fall? I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me." James Cleveland's gospel song testifies that God is my joy in the time of sorrow. God is my all in all. In the song, "Jesus, You're the Center of My Joy," Richard Smallwood bears witness to the impact of a relationship with Jesus in life direction is sought when sadness seems to be shattered and a hand is needed in time of loneliness. Similarly, Kirk Franklin sings about joy, joy, God's great joy that comes from a conversation with God in the midnight hour in the throes of deep distress and weakness. Joy amidst life's trials is further claimed in the song, "This Joy I Have. The world didn't give it, and the world can't take it away." This expression of claimed joy reflects again the source of joy whom surely Caesar identifies as nobody but Jesus. "This joy I have, this joy I have. The world cannot take it away."
"This joy I have, the world didn't give it to me.
Want to add here that joy is contagious. And that's a good thing. Joy is reckoned as happiness experienced as a result of spiritual transformation in Edwin Hawkins' song, "Oh Happy Day When Jesus Washed My Sins Away." In still other instances, the theme of joy comes as a request and as an invitation. Hezekiah Walker phrases his request to God for forgiveness in his gospel song, "Restore Your Joy to Me," or as Lamar Campbell's "Raise the Roof" tells about a man, Jesus, who gives sight to the blind, turns water into wine, unites every race, saves souls, cares for people, and gives victory. In response, he extends the invitation in the words, "So lift your hands in praise. Let's shout for joy." We do not always hear the life stories that prompt the messages of joy in gospel music or songs of earlier eras. However, these stories remind us that the songs are testimonies of people's very real life circumstances. In his autobiography, Kirk Franklin, noted gospel music artist and composer, tells his story of being born out of wedlock to a mother whom he said, end quote, "would have aborted me if a godly aunt hadn't intervened," end quote. He goes on to reveal his upbringing in poverty and of his continuing encounter of being derided and physically beaten. But he added, "God was there for me. He didn't let go. And that's where I am." From his story comes the testimony in which he repeats the biblical affirmation in Psalm 30b. "Weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning." Franklin goes on to confirm, in essence, that no matter what, and regardless of his life circumstance, the joy he has, which comes from God, will not be taken away. Franklin's message of joy and his ministry of sharing it also speak to a vital communal dimension evolving from his life story. He wrote about his keen awareness of others who, because of life's mayhem, are crying out for a listening ear and a search for joy. This recognition of the quest of others resulted in his sharing song such as "My Life is in Your Hands," that not simply assages worry and fear through assistance that joy comes in the morning, but provides an affirmative mantra to be said amidst brokenness. "I know that I can make it. I know that I can stand. No matter what may come my way, my life is in your hands." The importance of calling forth the memory of gospel music with young people lies not simply in the message of the songs, but in the stories of the writers that inspired them. Joy sought, struggled for, chosen, and embraced happens as part of our lived autobiographical soul stories. But more than this, the shared songs and stories undergirding them are reminders that joy extends beyond the self and that our joy is an opportunity to bring the same forth in somebody else's life. Providing this perspective with youth opens the way for creating spaces within which to invite their own truth-telling about stories of their lives and awareness of the stories of others. It opens the way for their disclosure of experiences of or their search for joy and for critical reflection on dominant messages in the songs for them. Furthermore, examples of gospel music as cultural collective memory offer opportunity to engage young people in considering the role of joy in vocation, or to consider what does it mean or what would it look like for us, for them, to actually be instruments of joy in the lives of others.
And finally, we want to look at stories in search of joy. So sharing stories, both orally and in writing or in poetic expression and preaching, have consistently been ways of revealing the particulars of our identities, our living environments, our relationships, our life events, and they're ways that we see, you know, what might be the way forward. Now, we have noted that joy happens and sometimes is thwarted and searched for in the day-to-day happenings of the lives of Black people. So in other words, joy is not just a concept. It's a human experience. So literature and short stories and poetry reaffirm this understanding of joy, and stories disclose joy in a very real present, absent, and tenuous experiences of the lives of people. So when joy is in short demand, either an unapologetic lament appears or a vision is set forth that presses forward towards recovery of joy. So there is an abundant attention to joy in the storied materials of novels and short stories and autobiographies and poetry. So I'm going to try to share just a few examples and point to what is revealed about the lives of youth and for the opportunity it affords young people and all of us, actually, to reflect on joy in our own lives, to raise questions about the presence or absence of joy, and to imagine what a way forward might look like. So we begin with the stories of young people. And our purpose in doing so is also a reminder, even though we've looked at all this historical material, is that young people bring something unique and invaluable to our conversations about joy if we would only listen to them. So during the 2017, a few months ago, Black History Month celebration, an invitation was extended in the Philadelphia Inquirer and the Daily News to share Black joy moments in a word, in photo, or video, or in the form of a story or poem. And so the intent was to focus on something that had changed their lives. And so we're going to share two stories that came out of this Philadelphia series. The first one is from a young man named Zach, 25-year-old Zach Blackwood. And he writes this story. He says, "My grandmother was one of the realest noble people I ever met in my life. My grandma was Dr. Franzella Elaine Delancey, a PhD and university professor for over 30 years. She passed away in 2011, but I continue to interact with her through the parts of her that remain physically present in my life. I have a sign from the door of her office. It says in capital letters, 'If Afrocentricity is a hustle, then let's dance.' I've met dozens of Black women who have reminded me of my grandmother since she died. She continues to inspire me through the facets of her life that I see in Black women every day. Charged particles of recognition. A Black woman smiling in the rain or ordering lemonade from the Starbucks. In 2014, I graduated from Drexel University, and my grandmother wasn't there to see me. I was invited to represent the art school by speaking at my graduation alongside a Black woman from another college. To my incredible surprise, she thanked Dr. F.E. Delancey in her speech by name with no knowledge of our relation. I cried. There is Black joy in remembering whose shoulders you're standing on. There is triumph, Black jubilation, Black gravity in knowing that other people remember their legacy too." Another story by a 23-year-old Nigerian-American woman also reflects some of these dimensions of Black joy. I quote her here. "One of the best ways I can define Black joy is seeing yourself in light that others try to dim. I was given many opportunities to believe that I wasn't beautiful or enough. Sometimes I entertained those thoughts, but the moment I actually enjoyed me, the undeveloped, flawed, and improper me, was when I found the joy. I found God within myself. I was bullied in middle school, taken advantage of in high school, and struggled with identity in college, but still I rejoice. I would admit it took a lot to put myself together after feeling shattered, but within that tough process, I learned how to love myself. I am a work in progress, but I'm enjoying the process. I dance in front of crowds, sing when I'm off tune, and most importantly, live carefree. My journey is why I started my magazine, Kamsi, for all the girls who were like me and need that moment to experience and express joy." In these stories, the young adults themselves testify to the wisdom of past generations and to the joy of remembering and sharing in these memories. The youth offer an opening for exploring and reflecting on the quest for joy in their own stories and in the literary heritage of African Americans as well. And so what we noticed is that the young people, what they seek and what they even found in this heritage is akin to what Robert Cataliotti describes in his description of African American oral tradition. And he writes, quote, that our oral tradition provides a way of remembering, a way of enduring, a way of mourning, a way of celebrating, a way of protesting and subverting, and ultimately a way of triumphing. So when we looked, and we don't have time to go through all of these examples, and across other stories in the pursuit of joy, we saw that often in short stories we could see things that were given us about a quest for joy in a personal perspective, quest for joy in the social, cultural, often also looking for joy in nature, a lot of poetry around nature and transcendence, as well as stories that were reflecting on biblical and theological experiences. So right now, though, we want to take a little bit of time, because I see where we are in the hour of the day, but to also think about the reality that at the end of this project, we also have developed a Finding Joy in Adolescence curriculum. And so we've got a couple of different ideas to share with you, and so I'm going to bring Dr. Ann back up to give you an overview, and then we're going to have a little bit of time, about 7 minutes, at our tables before the Q&A to engage in this conversation. All righty.
We developed what we call a Sankofa curriculum. And the Sankofa curriculum is based on that mythical bird called Sankofa, you remember, in which a part of it is facing forward and the rest is facing backwards, as though to go back and catch or fetch what was behind to bring it forward. In this Sankofa curriculum, we use what we call an idea strategy, the acronym IDEA. I for inviting you stories and connecting them with resource materials. The strategy assumes that young people do not enter curricular experiences as tabula rasa. To the contrary, they come with autobiographical soul stories of their everyday lives that are replete with pain and promise, sadness and joy, quandary and varied degrees of certainty about the direction of their lives. D, discovering for themselves meanings of joy presented in resource materials. On that, hearing and respecting the meanings youth themselves assign to joy is important in terms of deciphering those meanings and the sources of joy that are for them and that they see for themselves. E, exploring the materials for information and deeper insights that enlarge their understanding of joy. Exploration goes beyond young people's initial viewing of resource materials for how they connect with their already existing understandings of joy. Exploring has to do with engaging them in critical examination of the resources with focus on the search for joy, experiences of joy, struggles with joy, inhibitors of joy, ways of accessing joy, and the sources of joy, and joy as a generative act in community life. And A, applying understandings of joy. This strategy includes actually engaging these experiences as a part of the curricular endeavors. Now, the curricular sample that we've included here emphasizes three interconnected and overlapping themes that emerge from the research: finding and searching for joy, celebrating and choosing joy, and embodying joy. Specific practices in each of the upcoming thematic categories are means of engaging young people in the idea, plan, or strategy. The practices that you will become a little part of today can be developed into a series of lessons for use with Black youth, or they can be incorporated into a variety of one-time learning experiences such as workshops and retreats. But they're not designed to follow in a set order. There has to be time for young people themselves to have their say, to give their input. Now, as a part of our time today, let us dive in.
So one of the things that we found, and this is the joy of the internet, was the young man right here. The first picture is Cleaver Cruz. And so we mentioned in our presentation that he'd started something called the Black Joy Project. And on his Instagram account, he simply started posting pictures that represented joyful moments or moments where he wanted to celebrate joy instead of just struggle, adversity, violence, and things like that, which often is what comes up. And so in this, you'll see on the, in the center of your tables, there's a packet that has a little paper clip that talks about Black joy. So I invite you to have one person pull out their packet. It gives you a little bit of background information on the Black Joy Project. You can also find more stuff online. And at your table groups, I'm going to invite you to reflect on the quotes about Black joy that were posted on his Instagram site as part of this Black Joy Project. Then I want you to discuss your reflections at your tables. I want you to discuss your reflections briefly with the rest of your group. And then you can take a time and select one quote or idea that we've explored throughout the lecture that you connect with. And we invite you to journal. Now, of course, in youth ministry, we take journaling as a very broad term. So that means you can write, or you can draw, or you can create a piece of poetry. So you'll see that there's some colored paper and some markers and crayons in the center of your table as well. So this is what I invite you to do for a few minutes at your tables. So we've got a time for a traditional Q&A. I think Skip wants to say something. Do we transition before we transition? And then, but I want us to have a little bit of time to maybe report back from some of the things that you experienced at your table. For example, what are some of the things that emerged about your views of choosing joy that youth might have already had, or that these quotes kind of emerged or like brought up for us? Or what emerged that is new? So maybe just general reflections, general questions, or, yes, so we'll start over here. I think, Mariah, do you have the?
We talked about the adolescent, and 2 months ago, they compared this group of young people as being like a lobster. Mm-hmm. They shed in the growth. And so this would be a very vulnerable time for our teens, and also it would be the opportunity that we could mold and shape them during the shedding of their shell. So that's what we talked about at this table.
Excellent, thank you. Talk about some of the developmental things around why this would be a good place or a conversation. Other thoughts or ideas? Reflections on the quotes, or some of the ideas that were shared in the at your table?
So we really like this one about Black joy is the opportunity to bring life to the next generation. Mm-hmm. We have a partner here that she's pregnant, and they were talking about bringing life to their next generation. So that really spoke to us.
Excellent. Is there another over here? This group, or?
Just the gift that this work is to those of us who lead young people, the invitation for us to remember, mm-hmm. and therefore connect, reconnect with the joy.
Thanks. That's fine. Is there one more?
As we were discussing here about the lobster, it brought to mind a scripture in Ezekiel where it talks about the molting of the eagle and how our youth will perhaps come to some point in time where they will shed their youthful thoughts and then look to the joy of the Lord.
I saw one more hand, and then, I see lots of hands over here.
I just I wrote a little poem about joy.
Thank you.
And prayer and whatnot. It's not that good, but I'll read it anyway. The joy of prayer, a timeless tradition, the feeling of joy transcends, found in life through nature, love, God, and tradition. Joy does not discriminate.
Thank you. Any other creative reflections or comments? We have one right here.
What struck me about a lot of this was the idea of the joy being released through the music. Mm-hmm. And when you think of the songs that you have in church or you're using in youth group or wherever, if it's something that's really going to shake your soul, it's going to be good for you. And then you're joyful and you're happy and you're into whatever anyone's saying to you because you're open. Mm-hmm. So the music, to me, is key. Mm.
Yes. I think I saw a hand. Phil, were you trying to get in there? Huh. Very nice. Yes.
Transition,
the arithmetic of joy is multiplication, not division.
Now there is much, much more that can be said and will be said after a tiny little intermission for commercial announcements. But first, I just want to make sure before the end, we thank Dr. Ann Wimberly and Dr. Almeda Wright for an amazing presentation. And I want you to watch your inboxes for the continuation of their project, Finding Joy in Adolescence, African American Stories from the Past for the Present. Both the curricular materials, right, which will be available nationally, and your monograph, which you intend to publish. This has the capacity to be an immense good and a gift to the entire nation, so I hope you'll follow the continuing work. Second, we have these expression of interest forms. Here's the way this is going to go. This meal is free as long as you give us this expression of interest form when you leave. It's 10 bucks. Just give us the 10 bucks if you don't want to give us one of these, but please give us these. Who could not be interested in this program? And if you'll just give us the expression of interest, we'll be able to communicate with you and help you get registered. I want to introduce Carolyn Engelhardt, who is the director of our Ministry Resource Center Library. All these amazing materials around the room are just a tiny, tiny fraction of the robust resources that we have in that Ministry Resource Center, which is in the library. I know Carolyn would be glad to give you a tour and talk to you about assessing these materials if you see her after the program. I've put a lot of these brochures on your table. Who has at least five volunteers, ministers, or parents who would be concerned about these questions? That ought to be everybody. I could go 10, 20, like an altar call, work this up, but I know. So I've given you plenty of these brochures to pass out. Please take them and make sure the word gets out about this important program so all the fruit of what's being brought together can bear fruit in our community. And then one last commercial announcement. There's some awfully good desserts that are going wasted back there, you know, and coffee and drinks. So if you just want to take a minute to pick them up and refuel, and if you need to leave us right now, thank you for coming today. Blessings on your ministry. We'll continue in about 2 minutes with a continuation of your responses to the exercise or questions that you may have for Dr. Wright and Dr. Wimberly. Thank you for coming. All right, now while you're filling out your expression of interest form, because I know you are, let's come back to order with questions and answers. Don't forget the coffee and the desserts, but we're going to come back to order for questions and answers for Dr. Wimberly and Dr. Wright. Who has a question? Where's our microphone?
Mariah. Right,
Thank you. My question is around the age. When I hear us say that we're looking at youth or young adults or young people, I often wonder what age in particular are we speaking to? Because when I look at the word, I usually think of anyone under the age of 18. But then I look at the reflections and the pieces that you brought in, and I see that they're 25, 23. And so what age are you speaking of?
Well, in reality, the word youth is an imprecise term. But also developmentally from the research, when we think about adolescence, current wisdom is that adolescence is expanding. So typically you're looking at something that's beginning around 13 for adolescent, like biological development, and probably not being fully developed and understood until about 30. While as most 30-year-olds would not call themselves adolescents, but they're still in this developmental trajectory. We call it something post-adolescence. And so in some ways, what we've looked at in terms of like the resources would apply for this more expansive range.
Thank you.
Yes.
And maybe when I would invite you to consider saying that out loud often, mm-hmm. because many of us, when we hear it, we don't hear it.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
No, that's helpful. That's an excellent question.
Yeah, and actually, we define the next 12 to 18.
Mm-hmm. Other questions? Hmm? In your table or?
In,
oh.
You know, it's also interesting to note in our units in Africa, there's no differentiation from the children all the way through young adulthood, that we would call young adults, 35 years old, they're all together. And they're considered youth. Or they say young people. And it's phenomenal to watch them because this intergenerational group share with one another. You see those youngsters, the very young, speaking with those who are older as though they were eyeball to eyeball. And those who are older are mentors, and they watch after, they listen to, they enfold, and they affirm. So it's a mutual kind of arrangement that in a way, I keep looking and say, we've lost it here. And we need to regain it here because that's how village works. Okay. And so I just wanted to say that because the model there is really quite, quite different, and it's so refreshing.
Mm-hmm. Other questions or reflections?
Okay, we're responding to the one that says, we provide the world with beauty, our cuisine, art, music, literature, poetry, dance are a testament to joy that resides in us, a spiritual gift that cannot be taken from us. And someone wrote, beauty is in the eye of the beholder. We find ours in the eyes of God. Our cuisine is both spicy, authentic, and made from things that others rejected, that we turned into a delicious masterpiece. Art, music, literature, poetry, all stemming from the creativity of God that resides inside of us. Dance, our rhythmic response to music, which helps to encourage our joy. All of the above responses to hardship, which cannot be taken from us.
I'm curious about what you've found in terms of the receptivity among young people to this approach.
Well, two things that are still ongoing with the curricular pieces that we actually tested out in the youth group, and so Dr. Ann and I were working with which group of young people to try the curriculum out, because whenever you write curriculum, you've got to field test it. And so we're doing some of that. But in terms of the practices, these are not new practices. They're ones that have actually been used somewhat in diffused ways, but for generations with young people. And so in current stuff, for example, I'm drawing from examples in our curricular ideas from a youth group that I've been running for a couple of years now in the area, and thinking about how do we really invite young people into this process of sharing, which is why the idea strategy starts with inviting the stories of young people. And that's sometimes the hardest work, of really getting them to figure out out how to tell their story, how to vocalize it, but many of them have a story to share, and if they start there, then they can start to see and make links or connections to other narratives, to other parts of history, and then we push them to go deeper and further into that. And so in terms of young people, there's a way that often we assume a level of resistance that's not there. It's because we're not patient enough to spend time listening and engaging with young people such that they trust us to share.
In the Youth Hope Builders Academy that I direct in Atlanta, Georgia, at Interdenominational Theological Center, during the summer residential programs that we had from 2002 to 2012, a 10-year period, there was always time for the community to testify. Youth were invited into testimony. And a way of inviting them into testimony, I can remember one instance when each youth was given a rock. And on that stone, they were to put something that symbolized where they were at that point. It could be joy, it could be sorrow, it could be a hope, it could be a difficulty that they were in at that moment, it could be a disappointment. Whatever that word was, they would write it on the rock. And then that rock became a way of inviting them to say, okay, share something about what you put there. And wow, it's like the floodgates opened up. And then that led to our moments of lament, because young people need occasions where they can really let it all hang out about what's really, really bothering them. And so that one piece of the hanging onto that rock gave them an opportunity to really tell it, and then for the whole community to engage in lament. And then out of that, okay, how do we sing? How do we get through that? And of course, the circle was always the way, coming together in a circle and singing in the circle and crying in the circle and building and holding one another in the circle. So it does work, but you also have to have a community of welcome and comfort and a recognition and affirmation that those who were there, the leaders are going to be there, and the leaders are going to share too. They have their rock as well. And so they're going to share their stories as well. If there aren't any other questions, may we ask you to do this? Would you form a circle?